The AI of these helpers should be vastly improved from Spelunky 1. Although,
except
right,
in that
right
case.
There, he didn't really show that off.
Hey guys, welcome back to PlayStation Underground. You got Kristen and the crew here. We are playing Spelunky 2, and we are joined by Derek Yu. Hey, Derek.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Thank you. And we are already choosing our adventurer of the folks.
Can I interject real quick and just say, quick character select. I don't have to hit left or right like 10 times to get to my favorite character anymore. Already Spelunky 2 is delivering.
It's delivering the hits.
I was going to say, we have Justin and Sid joining as well. We are all super, super hyped for Spelunky 2. Big fans over on the PlayStation team. Derek, tell us a little bit for folks who maybe didn't play the original Spelunky or it's just been a while. Tell us a little bit about the world of Spelunky 2.
So I would call Spelunky 2 a roguelike platformer, or I would call Spelunky a roguelike platformer. And it was one of the first roguelike platformers, if not the first, maybe. So yeah, it was kind of cool to be one of the first in the genre, I suppose.
And one of the most influential.
Yeah.
Yeah, we've already got some great music. Yeah, listen to this music in this opening area. So cool.
I know.
I love the music in the first game.
Eric Cirka, who did the music for the first game, he came back for Spelunky 2 to do the music and the audio. And I think the whole soundscape of the game is really cool, very immersive. There are thousands of sound effects for all kinds of things you can do in the game.
Is that a little dung beetle I saw up there?
It is, yeah.
I love it.
That's one of the new little critters in the game.
The little pup. Love the little pug.
I'm seeing so many differences, like the totem there. It just has kind of a little thing that pushes you instead of just immediately impaling you, it looks like. So that'll, I guess if you get hit by that, you'll get launched into a wall or something.
Yeah, so I mean, you're gonna see things in Spelunky 2 that are familiar if you've played Spelunky 1, but the context is different. There are a lot more details. That was a new item there.
Yeah, that's good. That's going to be good for the people who are playing for points, because that's a popular thing on Twitch is people will try to go for high scores. But a lot of times that involves, I think, getting the ghost to come and clear out areas for you. So that seems like a way you can kind of manipulate that a little bit.
Yeah, it's a high risk, high reward item that you can use to your advantage if you know what you're doing.
Man, I wish that I had a pug that could just help me on my adventures like that.
Oh, the ghost is... Whoa, what's going on with the...
Oh.
Yeah, there's some new tricks with the ghost.
Game over. And that's it, guys. Thanks right now.
Yeah. First death of the day.
We're already seeing so many new things.
And you can see the journal at the end gives you a little recap of your run.
Oh, I love that. Oh, no.
Oh, we got mounts.
It's a turkey here.
Oh, no.
So what's this mechanic with the hearts around it? Does the turkey have to love you before it'll let you ride it?
Yeah, so you will encounter wild turkeys in the game. And you can tame them and ride them.
Yes.
And the turkey is one type of mount that you can find in the game. There are different types.
Do the different types of mounts have different abilities, or are they cosmetic?
They do have different abilities, yeah, for sure.
Oh, cool.
Nice.
Turkey's punching with his head.
Yeah.
Oh, so you can float. Okay, so that's kind of like the cape in the first game?
It is, yeah. And they don't tend to last that long in Spelunky 2.
Yeah.
We'll see how long Anna can keep hers.
So does this replace the cape, or is the cape also still around? Are you using the mounts to kind of replace those abilities?
The cape is also in the game. They end up being fairly different in a variety of ways.
Oh, okay. Sorry, I'm just going to be asking all these nitty-gritty questions.
Right. Well, for one thing, you can't the cape can't get killed, for one thing. That's one big difference.
All right, guys, we've made it past the first level.
But the cape also can't, like, attack pots to break them and stuff.
Yeah,
so,
that's
like,
exactly right.
Yeah.
And there are other things that you can do with the turkey that I won't spoil right now. But
okay.
Needless to say, there are just a lot of different ways that you can interact with some of these new features in Spelunky 2. As well as the returning features, like even enemies like the caveman, which were just all over the place in Spelunky 1. Oh, here's a new NPC.
Oh.
I was going to say, helping him find some turkeys.
Yeah, so you can donate the turkey there. I'm sure that does something.
It does. It does. And we decided not to show exactly what happens, you know, if you kind of c- continue bringing turkeys to him.
Yeah. The original Spelunky was a game all about like finding secrets, the City of Gold, the Hell Runs, the Eggplant Run, all that stuff. And it looks like there are, and you talked about this in a recent PlayStation blog post that you actually wrote for us. You talked about runs being more dense and more varied. And I'm already seeing a lot of that here.
Yeah. Popping into the store here, which is like essential to Spelunky.
Yeah, the store experience is a little bit deeper, Derek. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, it's definitely deeper and more nuanced. I mean, we realized after Spelunky 1 that the store is, it's such a central part of the Spelunky experience. And so we've done a lot with stores. There's like more varieties of stores that you can encounter, and there are little like variations even to the existing stores from Spelunky 1. And you know, I think just to kind of expand on the concept of the store, we do have like other NPCs that you can interact with, like that guy that really likes turkeys.
That just wants turkey.
And wants turkeys, right. So we realize like the shopkeeper is such an interesting character, and he's the central focus of a lot of people's like favorite Spelunky stories. And so we really wanted to just expand on that, add more characters like that that have, you know, that you can help, that you can attack if you want to, things like that. And it just, I think it really makes every run a lot more rich. Yeah, there's a cave mole there.
Oh my goodness.
He's like, how dare you take that?
I think Spelunky 2 is going to feel a lot more like dynamic. You know, the cave mole kind of like digs around in the ground and can kind of like move around in diagonals and stuff and just pop out of the wall when you least expect it.
Yeah, yeah. So in the original Spelunky, I watched a lot of speedruns, and speedruns usually, they go one of two ways. People either look for the jetpack plus shotgun combo, or they go for the teleporter and try to do the, you know, I don't know how people do the teleporter as proficiently as they do, but do you think that there's like a standard loadout that speedrunners are going to go for, or was it a goal of yours to try and diversify speedruns a little bit?
It was a big goal to make sure that there wasn't just one kit that you're always trying to look for. And I think that also speaks to the shopping experience, where in Spelunky 1, when people got really good at the game, this is a boss.
Nice.
Cool.
Kind of a mini boss. But yeah, in Spelunky 1, when you got good at the game, I heard a lot of people say, well, there's basically no reason not to rob the shop, right? Because you don't have to pay.
Yeah.
And if you're good enough, you can kind of avoid the shopkeepers. So in Spelunky 2, there are a lot more, I think, useful items. I think a lot of the items that didn't get used as much are more useful. And there's more reasons not to rob the shop. Like, I think even
that's
at
always
like,
a great mentality. There's more reasons to not rob this place.
Yeah,
that's
exactly.
Actually a relief to hear, because I was never very good at robbing the shop and getting out alive, but it felt like that was kind of crucial if you wanted to, say, complete a hell run. That was almost mandatory to be able to complete a hell run. So I'm glad to hear that that's not, you know, kind of the only way to play. Poor guy.
Yeah, whoops.
R.I.P.
And the AI of these helpers should be vastly improved from Spelunky 1. Although,
except in that case.
Right there, he didn't really show that off.
Oh, that was so cool.
Oh, got a robot buddy? Oh, man.
Yeah, this is like super different.
This is like some kind of abandoned factory or something?
Yeah, this is a completely new area. And
oh, no.
Yeah, she missed the... I think Anna was trying to jump on top of that rock dog right there and just barely missed.
Speaking of new stuff, I noticed the hub area at the beginning of the game is drastically expanded. I'm not sure if that's something we're going to see a little bit later, but can you give us a quick overview of what's going on there with that? I think you called it a community that you're building.
Yeah, so that's called Base Camp now. We have a name for it, and if you just scroll back to that beginning part, you will see that you can actually talk to the other player characters in the game that you're not playing as. So
nice.
The idea is that, you know, for Spelunky 2, I wanted players to have the feeling of having a community in game that they can talk to and feel supported by.
Yeah.
Because the you know, like in Spelunky 1, or like with Spelunky 1 outside of the game, there was a really great community. There is still a really great community of players that have kind of kept the game going all this time. And I wanted to have that feeling in the game itself.
Nice.
And as you unlock new characters in the game, Basecamp will expand and it'll just feel like a bustling little place that you've created.
Nice.
And, you know, the characters in there will be talking about their runs. They'll be wishing you luck, maybe even giving a little bit of advice, things like that.
So they're actually out there, like, doing their own runs and stuff, too. That's fun.
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, so you can feel like you have a community in and out of the game.
Oh, that's great. Are they going to be dropping hints like, oh, I noticed something strange in this area? Or is that going to be more up to the player?
It'll be more up to the player because, you know, ultimately we do want the player to be the one to be kind of discovering all the secrets themselves.
I was going to say, the more you play, the more you're going to uncover and unlock.
Yeah, but, they will mention things that are in the game.
Yeah.
Like a character might talk about, I died to this trap in my last run, yes, and things like that.
Kali accepts your sacrifice.
I love it.
Kali's back for sure.
Hey, Derek, so the game, the original game, is just well known for having a really, really great sort of procedural level design. I mean, have you made some tweaks in that system for how Spelunky 2 works just to make it more varied or just kind of more diverse?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, you saw it just a little while ago that Colin went into a back layer. So every level has like a back layer behind it that you might be able to access. And that part of the level is also randomly generated.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
And it gives the game kind of like a three-dimensional feeling, even though it's a 2D game and the gameplay is 2D. So here he's going to go into another door and there's a little character there.
Yeah, this is cool.
Huh? Hello.
Oh,
she's saying
stuck.
Thank you. You push that block down so she can get out, and she thanks you.
So would she now show up at your base camp?
She won't because she's not a player character. She's like one of the NPCs, that can appear in runs.
Got it.
But helping her, you know, it may have an effect later in your run.
Okay.
If you encounter her again.
Sure.
So we've been checking out Adventure Mode, but there's also a couple other modes that were listed. There's this Arena Mode, which is like an expanded version of Deathmatch.
Yeah, that's right. Deathmatch was a mode that I personally really enjoyed, and it turns out a lot of other people did too, but I think it took kind of a backseat to Adventure Mode in Spelunky 1. And so in Spelunky 2, it's been expanded into what's called Arena Mode, where Deathmatch is like one of the formats. And there's also another one called Hold the Idol, where you just try to grab an idol and hold on to it for as long as possible. And there'll just be a lot more options to make getting into a like PvP match simpler, more streamlined, and allow you to customize it however you like.
Got it.
So in Spelunky, in the original Spelunky, it's a game that I think found a lot of life in its secrets. Oh, no! Do you think that Spelunky 2 is going to enjoy a similar kind of long life as people find some of the secrets you've squirreled really deeply away?
That's our hope, for sure. And that was another cut to a new character.
Yeah.
Back to the volcano area.
I'm loving those lava physics. It's great.
Yeah, that's another thing that we added to just make the world feel more dynamic, more reactive. I the hope is that people will be able to stream this game for years to come and keep finding new things to do. You know, I keep talking about players finding things like secrets in the game that even the developers don't know about. And I think that was true of Spelunky 1. And I feel like that should be doubly true of Spelunky 2 because the game is just so much bigger, denser, more rich. I think we've added, a lot of just different items and places and people that you can interact with that you can interact with in a much deeper way.
Oh, that was a bold move.
You might notice the explosions are really big in this segment, and that's because Rafi the Sloth has a power pack, which makes the bombs big.
Interesting. Oh, that's going to be a go-to item for sure.
I love him.
Yeah, it's just a very, like, arcadey power-up.
Do you have any favorite items?
It's hard to pick. I do like the power pack, just because I think it's a, yeah, it's a fairly unique item, because bombs generally in Spelunky 1, you could make them sticky, but that was the only thing you could really do to modify them. So I think to give you the big bombs is a pretty big change. And it also does some other things, like when you whip with a power pack on, your whip will have a little fire on the end.
Oh, okay. Are there other like modifier pieces of gear in there as well?
To modify things like your whip?
Yeah.
No, the power pack is kind of unique in that regard.
Gotcha.
Got it.
So four-leaf clover there, you feel protected. Like, what does that mean?
I don't know if I want to say exactly.
Oh, okay, okay.
Folks will have to play for themselves to find out.
Yeah, it's an interesting item, though. For
nice.
Sure.
Well, thank you so much, Derek, for giving us this look at Spelunky 2, which is out now on PS4.
プレイステーション